The Story of the Wicked Half-Brothers. In the city of Harran there once lived a king who had every happiness which life and fortune could bestow save that he lacked an heir. Although, according to royal custom, he had in his household 50 wives, fair to look upon and affectionate in disposition, and though he continually invoked on these unions the blessing of heaven, still he remained childless. For which cause all his joy was turned to affliction, and his wealth and power and magnificence became as of no account. Now one night as he slept there appeared before him an old man of venerable appearance who, addressing him in mild accents, spoke thus. The prayer of the faithful among 50 has been heard. Arise, therefore, and go into the gardens of your palace and cause the gardener to bring you a pomegranate fully ripe. Eat as many of the seeds as you desire, children, and your wish shall be fulfilled. Immediately upon awaking, the king remembered the dream, and going down into the gardens of the palace, he took 50 pomegranate seeds, and counting them one by one, ate them all. So in due course, according to the promise of his dream, each of his wives gave birth to a son all about the same time. To this, however, there was an exception, for one of the 50 whose name was Piruz, the fairest and the most honorably born, she alone, as time went on, showed no sign of that which was expected of her. Then was the king's anger kindled against her because in her alone the promise of his dream was not fulfilled, and deeming such a one hateful in the eyes of heaven, he was minded to put her to death. His vizier, however, dissuaded him. Time alone can show, said he, whether her demerits are so great as you now suppose. Let her go back to her own people and remain in banishment until the will of heaven shall declare itself, and if within due time she give birth to a son, then can she return to you with all honor. So the king did as his vizier advised, and sent Piruz back to her own country to the court of the prince of Samaria. And there before long she who had seemed barren had the joy of becoming a mother and gave birth to a son whom she named Codadad, that is to say, the gift of God. Nevertheless, because the king of Harran had put upon her so public a disgrace, the prince of Samaria would send no word to him of the event. So the young prince was brought up at his uncle's court, and there he learned to ride and to shoot and to perform such warlike feats as become a prince, and in all that country he had no equal for accomplishment or courage. Now one day, when Codadad had reached the age of 18, word came to him that his father the king of Harran was engaged in war and surrounded by enemies. So the prince said to his mother, "Now is it time that I should go and prove myself worthy of my birth and the equal of my brethren. For here in Samaria all is peace and indolence, but in Harran are hardship and dangers, and great deeds waiting to be done." And his mother said to him, "O my son, since it seems good to thee, go. But how wilt thou declare thyself to thy father, or cause him to believe thy word, seeing that he is ignorant of thy birth?" Codadad answered, "I will so declare myself by my deeds that before my father knows the truth he shall wish that it were true." So he departed and came in princely arms to the city of Harran, and there offered his service to the king against all his enemies. Now, no sooner had the king looked upon the youth than his heart was drawn toward him because of his beauty and the secret ties of blood, but when he asked from what country he came, Codadad answered, "I am the son of an emir of Cairo, and wherever there is war one go to win fame, nor do I care in what cause I fight so long as I be proved worthy." The prince was not slow in making his valor known. Before long he had risen to the command of the whole army, not only over the heads of his brethren but also of the more experienced officers. And thereafter, when peace was re-established, the king, finding Codadad as prudent as he was valiant, appointed him governor to the young princes. Now this act, though justified by merit, could not fail to increase the hatred and jealousy which Codadad's brethren had long felt towards him. "What," they cried, "shall this stranger not only steal from us the first place in the king's favor, but must we also be in obedience to his ruling and judgment? Surely if we do so we are no sons of a king." So they conspired together how best to be rid of him. One said, "Let us fall upon him with our swords." "No, no," said another, "for so doing we shall but bring punishment upon ourselves. But let us so arrange matters as to draw on him the weight of the king's anger, thus shall our vengeance be made both safe and complete." To this the other princes agreed. So forming a design which seemed favorable to their end they approached Codadad, and besought his permission to go forth together on a hunting expedition, promising to return the same day. Codadad, deeming the request reasonable, immediately granted it. The brothers departed, but they did not return. On the third day the king made inquiry as to the reason of their absence. Codadad replied that they were gone on a hunting expedition but had promised to return much sooner. Another day passed and the king grew anxious. Yet another, and he became furious, and all his wrath was directed against Codadad. "O traitor," he cried, "why hast thou neglected thy trust and allowed my sons to go anywhere unaccompanied by thee? Now go instantly and search for them, and if thou find them not, be assured that on thy head shall fall the penalty." At these words the prince was filled with sudden foreboding, for he knew that the brothers had no love for him, and well could he see now the danger into which he had fallen. All he could do, however, was to obey. So furnishing himself with arms and a horse good for travelling, he set out in search of his brethren. After some days employed in a fruitless quest, he came to a desolate tract in the midst of which stood a castle of black marble. As he approached, he beheld at an upper window a damsel of marvellous beauty, with torn garments, dishevelled hair, and a countenance expressive of the most lively affliction, who immediately that she set eyes on him wrung her hands and waved him away, crying, "Oh, fly, fly from this place of death and the monster which inhabits it. For here lives a black giant which feeds on human flesh, seizing all he can find. Even now in his dungeons you may hear the cries of those whom for his next meal he will devour." "Madam," replied the prince, "for my safety you need have no care. Only be good enough to inform me who you are and how you came to be in your present plight." "I come from Cairo," she replied, "where my birth gives me rank. And as I was travelling from thence on my road to Baghdad, this monstrous Eritrean suddenly fell upon us, and having slain my escort brought me hither a captive, to endure, if heaven refuses me succour, things far worse than death. But though I know my own peril, I will not see others perish in a vain attempt to rescue me, therefore once more I entreat you to fly ere it be too late." But even as she spoke, the Eritrean, a horrible and gigantic monster of loathsome appearance, came in sight moving rapidly toward the palace. No sooner had he caught sight of the prince than he rushed upon him with growls of fury, and drawing his scimitar aimed at him a blow which, had it found him, must there and then have ended the fight. The prince, however, swerved nimbly under the stroke, and reaching his farthest, wounded the giant in the knee. Then wheeling his charger about before the Eritrean could turn on his maimed limb, he attacked him from the rear, and with one fortunate blow brought him to earth. Instantly, before the giant could gather up his huge length and regain his vantage, Codadad spurred forward and with a single sweep of his sword smote off his head. Meanwhile, all breathless above, the lady had leaned watching the contest. Now, seeing that victory was secured, she gave free vent to her joy and gratitude. "O Prince of Men," she cried, "now is revealed to me the high rank to which thou wast born. Finish, then, thy work. Take from the girdle of yonder wretch the keys of the castle and come quickly to the release of me and my fellow prisoners." The prince did according to her directions. As he opened the gates and entered the forecourt, the lady advanced to meet him, ready, had he permitted it, to throw herself in gratitude at his feet. And now, as he beheld near at hand the beauty which had charmed him from a distance, Codadad realized how great had been his fortune, and with his whole heart rejoiced at the deliverance of one in whose nature so much virtue and grace seemed blended. But while he was thus lost in the contemplation of her loveliness, there arose from the basement of the castle a dreadful sound of crying and lamentation. "What is that?" inquired the prince. "It is the cry of the prisoners," replied the lady, "to whom, I doubt not, the opening of the gates has betokened the monster's return. Come, therefore, quickly and relieve them of their misery." And so saying, she pointed to the door which led to the place of confinement. Thither, accompanied by the lady, went Codadad with all speed. Descending by a dark stair, he came upon a vast cavern dimly lighted, around the walls of which 100 prisoners lay chained. Instantly he set to work to loose their bonds, informing them at the same time of the death of their captor and of their freedom from all further danger. At these unexpected tidings the captives raised a cry of joy and thanksgiving. But great as was their surprise at such unlooked-for deliverance, greater still was that of the prince when, on bringing them to the light, he discovered that 49 of the 100 whom he had released were his own brethren. The princes received the cordial embraces of their deliverer with little embarrassment, for the disaster into which they had fallen had caused them almost entirely to forget their original intent. Satisfied with expressing in proper terms their obligation and gratitude toward Codadad, they now joined eagerly in his survey of the castle. There, upon examination, they found an extraordinary variety and wealth of booty, consisting for the most part of merchandise which the Eritrean had pillaged from passing caravans, some of it actually belonging to those whom Codadad had so recently rescued. The prince accordingly ordered the merchants each to take what he recognized as his own, and this being done, he divided the rest equally between them. The question then arose how they should remove the plunder from a place so desolately situated, where it would seem impossible to procure means of conveyance. But on a further search they found not only the camels of the merchants, but also the horses on which the princes of Harran had ridden. And as, at their approach, the black slaves who were in charge of the stables fell into headlong flight, Codadad and his companions found themselves left in undisputed possession. The merchants therefore loaded their camels, and with renewed protestations of gratitude departed on the several roads by which their avocations called them. When they were gone, Codadad's next care was to inquire of the lady in what direction she wished to travel, promising that he and the princes would conduct her in safety to any place she might name. The lady replied, thanking him for his generous offer. "But wherever I go," said she, "it cannot be to my own country, for not only is it too far distant, but cruel misfortune has separated me from it forever. And since you have put me under so great an obligation, let me now confess the truth which before I thought it prudent to conceal. My dignity of rank is far higher than that to which I recently laid claim. In me you behold a king's daughter, and if it will interest you to hear the story of my misfortunes, I shall be happy to recount it." Assured of the lively sympathy of her auditors, she began as follows.